Language resource center Baker, where with sign language we are equal. And that's the motivation, that is the strength, that is the spirit. And today, I want to thank you one more time for visiting this channel, where we continue talking about issues that affect us, that affect the deaf people who need our intervention. And today, I want us to think and reflect about the deaf people when they fall sick, when they are unwell and they need medication. They have an issue that they are not able maybe to bring it to the forefront, or it's not evident on them, like an injury or a swelling or something that has some physical symptoms. It's very difficult for the deaf community. Sometimes they'll go to the hospital, and when they get there, they'll get the medical staff, and it is very, very, it's very, very bad. The situation is not good for them, especially if the medical or healthcare givers do not know sign language. I want to challenge every healthcare worker, including them that do VCT counseling, the doctors, the nurses who are usually the patients, to think about this one area. This one is for you medical staff, that you need to know the basics of sign language, that you may be able to help the deaf community. What happens when they come to you? Usually, when a patient visits a health facility, what they do, the doctor there will try to get the history of the patient, try to know what happened, are there any medicines or drugs they are taking. They try to get the history of that patient to know how they are going to help them. And here is a patient who is deaf. And when they get to you, they are not talking, you're not very sure what they are hearing from. We have had cases where the deaf went to the hospital and they were not able to communicate with the health caregiver. And what happened, they were given some medicines, but when they got home, they never used the medication. They are not using it because they do not trust the doctor, but they are not using them because they are not very sure whether they are being treated for the sickness or ailment that took them to the hospital in the first place. They ask questions like this: if we did not talk with the doctor, if we did not communicate with the clinical officer, if there was no communication between me and them, then how did they know what I was hearing from? So out of their own concern, they choose not to take the drugs. Not that they are not unwell, they're not sick. And if they do take the medication, they do out of pain, suffering, out of what they could be going through. That happens because they're not sure the effects the drug would have on them if it is not for the intended ailment. Is it that serious? I remember sometimes my friends who are deaf, they would ask me to take them to the hospital. They would request me to come and talk with the clinical officer, and then I take them through the process. And it's not very good, it's not very nice, because even the confidentiality of the patient is now between the interpreter and the doctor. We are three of us. I know interpreters have a code of ethics, and one of the codes of ethics is to maintain confidentiality, and don't have any doubt on that. But it's good to respect the patient. It's good to have a doctor. It's good to have a clinical officer who understand sign language. It's good to have one. If not all, at least in each health facility, there should be a nurse, a clinical officer, a rotor technician, somebody who knows sign language in the medical facility. What happens? Sometimes they'll come and queue in the long lines, especially if it is not labeled well. I want to challenge our health facility managers that they need to label our points of service in the hospitals, specifically because of the deaf people. Don't assume that everybody working there is hearing. There are some who will not hear what is happening aloud, the instructions being given. They are being told to go to from this room to the other room, go to the X-ray room, go to the laboratory. And all along, they are not sure. They are not aware what they are intended to do. So I want to ask that hospitals and other health facilities to try and have sign language interpreters. Sometimes we volunteer. I remember there is a time I went to the hospital with a patient who was deaf, and I told the clerk officer that I cannot keep lining up, you know, the queues in the public hospitals, because I need to go back to my workstation. So I requested him to allow the deaf patient to come and be attended so that I can be released and gone. And the doctor could not understand, the clinic officer could not understand why I should jump queue. I told him the guy is deaf and I'm an interpreter. Then he was like, we cannot jump the queue. Mm-hmm. We have to queue and line up with the rest. So I had to be patient. And we went along the queue, and after about an hour, we got to the doctor. And then as he refused me to take advantage and go area, I also decided to keep quiet. Then let him treat the patient. And to cut the whole story short, the doctor realized that he could not communicate with the deaf patient. I don't know what was going through his mind, because I know he knew about deafness as a clinical officer, but I tend to think he did not appreciate the barrier that exists between the hearing and the medical care providers. I want to challenge you that you need, as a medical practitioner, you need to know at least the basic sign language. You can be able to take the history of your patient. If you need to treat somebody or to give medicines or drugs, even them that are doing in pharmacies and chemists, you need to know a bit of sign language. So when somebody comes in, you are able to describe to them, explain to them how they are going to take these drugs. And it's important. It's very important. Doctors, clinical officers, nurses, I know there's one hospital in Kiambu. Sometimes back, we did some training for the nurses. And along the way, I don't know if they are still practicing, but I want to believe they are still in the facility. And or wherever they are assisting the deaf to access health services. That the VZT, how many hospitals do we have counselors who knows or understands or uses sign language? How do you counsel somebody who is deaf on how is going to continue living and you have a language barrier? And that's why at Sign Language Resource Center, we say our greatest duty, our biggest duty, is bridging the gap between you, the hearing, and the deaf outside there. It is bridging the gap between you, medical care person, to those hearing people with hearing difficulties. It is your duty, it's your responsibility to take it up, to take a positive frame, and do something. If you're in the management or if you're in management, you can organize for your staff. We do that training with you. We train them and they become more and more useful. So the next time you meet a deaf person, you will be able to ask them, to ask them, how are you feeling? Or you feel how? That's how you do it. And then they'll be able to tell you, me, na feel, I'm not well. Or this is paining, I have some pain here and there. And then you are able to do a prescription for them. And when you do a prescription for them, you are able to explain to them how they are going to take their medication. Isn't that good? And that's why we keep asking that you keep to this channel. You keep checking on the videos that we keep posting. And among the videos inside there or down there, we have basic sign language, ABCD, how you can introduce yourself, how you can do the basic sign language. And if it gets tough on you, then we are there to come in and help you to get through it. So this is very, very important. It is very, very critical. You need to learn sign language. And when you know sign language, I want to say this close to you, that we say, with sign language, we are equal. I want to challenge you. Mm-hmm. Take up the challenge. I also want to invite you to come and subscribe to Sign Language Resource Center Kenya, and from there you will learn more. Thank you.